Welcome back to Connections on AM 1480 WLDA. Brian O'Neill on the phone with a radiologist from Maine, Dr. Michael Nissenbaum. Dr. Nissenbaum, you have a slideshow that you do presentations with, and I've seen that slideshow online in it, and you discussed this a little bit earlier in the show, the hopelessness that people feel about living in a wind farm area. Can you tell us about that?
Well, it turns out, I mean, I can tell you the quotes that, I basically just quoted what people were telling me, and these were all different people. The quotes range from nobody will help us to no options, they can't leave and they can't live here. Another elderly woman said, this is an awful thing to have happened to you. And then a lot of people were upset because people don't believe them. They feel that their complaints fall on deaf ears. One quote was, no one cares, no one listens. Another quote was, they just tread on us. Another quote was, it's very hard watching my child suffer. And these people here, most of them have put their life savings into their property, into their homes. These are actually nice homes that are nicely situated on the hillside in Mars Hill. A lot of pride of ownership there. And what they found, what I did inquire in the study was whether they considered moving away, and the vast majority had considered moving away. And when they were asked, why didn't you move away, they also said they couldn't afford to. And eight out of the nine homes that I had spoken with indicated that they had had official appraisals done, and the drop in value of their homes was such that it made it prohibitive for them to sell and move away. So they basically were trapped in their homes, and they could not leave, and yet they were putting up with this. And I believe that largely contributed to the hopelessness.
I can believe that. I talked with a real estate agent who told me that he was unable to sell property, and I talked to a person who lives in Howard who's been trying to sell. Howard is a local town here in Steuben County, and I talked to a man in Howard who said every time when he tries to sell a piece of property, and when he tells people about the wind turbines, that's the end of the deal.
Right.
Doctor, wondering, is it possible that some of the depression-type feelings you discuss in your study are a result not only of the psychological pressures of not being able to sell your home and dealing with the lack of money that you'll get if you ever are able to sell it, but is it possible that these emotional problems that are going on could be a result of the physical effects of living around a wind turbine, possibly from the low-frequency noise or maybe the blade flicker? Is there a possibility of
It's a complex issue, but I think as far as most people are concerned, you have to go no farther than the sleep disturbance. When you are chronically sleep-deprived, that will result in all sorts of negative psychiatric and physical symptomatology over time. It stresses you when you don't sleep. It has effects on blood pressure. It has effects on mood. You become irritable. You argue. These are all. This is not rocket science. This is all known. You go for weeks and weeks and months with not getting the sleep that you require. It'll have some significant effects. And however, going beyond that, there are some very complex interplays of the nature of wind turbine sound with the neurologic system of human beings. There are low frequency sounds. I won't say specifically that these are sounds that you can't hear. There are certainly sounds that you can hear. There's something about the quality of wind turbine noise that has been shown over and over to be at an equivalent sound pressure level more annoying than other sources of sound, such as highway or rail yards or even airports. There's something about wind turbine noise that is more annoying at any given sound level compared to any other source of industrial noise in our environment. So there is something unique about it. It may be the pulsatility, it may be the frequency of the pulsatility, it may be the lower frequency components. Whatever it is, it travels and it penetrates homes, and it has much more disruptive effect on human beings than does any other source of noise in our environment, and that is proven.
We have a congressman in our area. His name is Congressman Eric Massa, and he's been doing a lot of town hall meetings lately. The main thing that he's been talking about, of course, is the health care reform. But one subject that's popping up a lot, because this is a big wind area, is wind energy. And he's stressed a number of times his concern about the possibility of the turbines causing epileptic seizures in people. Any idea as to how turbines could trigger a seizure, Doctor?
Well, this wasn't something that came up in my survey. I read about it, and you know, most people are familiar with the concept of light flickering bringing on seizures, and some physicians have opined that this is a theoretic possibility with the light flicker that may occur from wind turbines when the sun is passing through the blades of the turbine, either in the morning or in the evening during sunrise or sunset. But I have not seen that as being a specific complaint among the people I've interviewed. People have complained about issues from the flicker, but not specifically seizures.
Doctor, when you got into this study, was there anything at the end of it that surprised you? Did you learn anything that you weren't expecting to find out about in your study?
Well, I'll tell you. First of all, it's not done. The study is about halfway done. We've interviewed 30 control people who live about 2.5 miles away from the turbines, and the control group is critical because this allows us to compare an otherwise similar group of people who are not living close to the wind turbines, their frequency of symptoms. We will be compared with those people who are living close to the turbine. So it will allow us to perform statistical analysis and really increase the significance of the findings. So all of that is still underway. So I will say that what I'm describing today are the preliminary findings. The study will be completed, and we will have some very hard statistical data within a couple of months.
Do you think that there's anything people could do to protect themselves if they start getting headaches or ringing in their ears or any of the other symptoms that pop up when you have wind turbines in your area?
Well, with the spirit of the new administration, I would say that prevention is more important than trying to deal with things after the fact. I think it's very, very hard once these things are up and running to mitigate their effects. These are fairly low-frequency sounds. They travel both through the air and through the ground. They create rumble. You cannot, you know, block their entrance into your home in any way that we know about. Really, the best approach is to take steps to prevent these issues from ever occurring, and that means proper setbacks.
And when you say setbacks, you're talking about the distance that a wind turbine is from someone's home or property.
Right, from someone's home or, you know, the buildable boundary of their property. That's right.
Well, Dr. Nissenbaum, thank you so much for coming on Connections this morning here on AM 1480 WLEA. Are there any final thoughts you'd like to share with our listeners?
I think that whether or not to proceed with wind turbines in an area is a business decision, but I think if they are going to proceed with wind turbines in an area, it should be treated like any other industry, and proper safeguards should be put in place so that people are not stampeded by the goodwill there's a certain goodwill that exists in the population towards all forms of green energy and getting us off of oil that comes from the Mideast and so on, but that goodwill should not be exploited in a headlong rush to site these things too close to where people live. There's lots of room in both New York State as well as in Maine to place these things well away from people's homes, and I believe people should take steps to make sure that's the way that these projects are implemented.
Well, Dr. Michael Nissenbaum, thanks a lot for coming on Connections here this morning on AM 1480 WLEA. I hope our listeners pay a lot more attention to you than I did to the wind protesters when they complained to me about wind turbine health problems.
Well, it's my pleasure to be with you, and I hope this was useful.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Coming up next, the Roger Hedgecock Show here on AM 1480 WLEA.